I have this great pleasure of moderating this panel. I first would like to invite the panelists. Mr. Ajay Sawhney. He is actually the founding member, special officer for IIIT Hyderabad from the government of Andhra Pradesh then. So, Ajay, please go. So, Ajay was a mechanical engineer in 1984. He's an IS AP cadre from 1984 batch. And he was actually playing lead roles in total literacy programs at Nizamabad district then. He was also IT secretary at AP government, looking at various issues like e-governance, communications, broadband, and so on. And then he was the first principal secretary to the chief minister of newly found Andhra Pradesh state. But Mr. Ajay Sawhney has been always a special friend, a special person, particularly IIIT Hyderabad, holding its hand from the beginning and for many, many years to come.
Thank you, Ajay, for being here.
Now, second, I would like to request Jairam. Jairam, again, is a great friend and supporter of IIIT Hyderabad. He has an MBA from world's number one management school for entrepreneurship, Babson School. And then he has several years at Boston working with startups as well as for other companies. And then he has been spending last 12 years at Amazon. He's the director of product development as well as playing a major role in expanding Amazon's activities in India in general. And then, of course, he's a great evangelist of educational institutions. And then with his help, we would actually create new models for setting up industry and academia relationships. Last but not the least, a dear friend, Ajit Rangnekar. Ajit is the Director General of RICH, the Research and Innovation Council of Hyderabad. And he is also ex-dean of ISB. He is an engineer from IIT Bombay and graduated from IIM Ahmedabad, spent several years at PricewaterhouseCoopers. And then academic institutions, it's really very hard to place Ajit in one category. So today he is actually representing an academic setting which actually built new models for India, right? So I wanted to start where PJN left, Professor PJ Narayanan left the discussion, which is essentially about talking about two figures in US academia. He talked about Vannevar Bush, he talked about Frederick Terman, and then how each one of them actually built models just by being academic administrators of then not so great institutions. They pushed the government, they pushed entire society to set up schemes, to set up policies, to set up bodies so that so small changes actually result in big movements, and then a nation that actually is now the epicenter for all the innovation and then all the progress. So several aspects, including the science, the endless frontier aspects, where how the money should be given by the government to continuously in an uninterrupted manner to support basic fundamental research at academic institutions. And then how the whole ecosystem has to be developed in an unbiased manner, and who are the people who should be deciding these things more than anything else. And then the models, the thought process there actually led to creating agencies like NSF. Not just that, the spirit went on in distributing the kind of resources that they have and in encouraging real innovation and making sure that innovation is celebrated everywhere. And similarly, very in a frugal manner, how the institutions can be built from ground up and then excellence can be celebrated everywhere. That is the kind of roadmap that Dr. Terman had for Stanford. Coming to Indian settings, right? Right now, we are heading to be the most populous nation in less than a decade. And with the GDP growth of about 8%, we will soon have 500 middle class population demanding for higher education, quality education. And today, if you look at all the institutions together, good, bad, ugly, central, state, private, all of them put together cannot meet this demand. And then now we are actually at a cross junction where we need high quality educational institutions that will actually cater to the needs of this population that is aspiring to be receiving education. And if you don't fulfill that need, pretty soon the rogue societies will actually emerge. So it is in the interest of the nation, interest of the society, that we need to nurture, create great educational institutions. Actually, the Indian education institution, it is said, was actually designed for the elite. Not many people are expected to be educated. And then now, with the increased demand, this whole art is falling apart. All the rich and the elite are looking elsewhere for educating their children. They are sending them to other countries. And then all other people who are remaining here, they are losing their original thinking, their creativity, their thought process, their childhood to what we call as coaching, in order to get into very few high quality educational institutions that are available. So as Professor P.J. Narayanan mentioned earlier, setting up a new technology institutes like IITs will cost more than 2,000 crores, and there's a huge operational expense every year. So the government can set up only a few institutions. And it is also observed that the private universities focus on quantity rather than quality, and many of them are actually set up with vested interests. And those institutions, those private institutions that are actually doing well, they're often frustrated by the lack of support or the freedom and the meaningless constraints that are imposed by the regulatory bodies. So we have two major challenges today, among many, of course. One is the supply-demand gap, where India has a low rate of enrollment for higher education. It is around 18% now. Whereas if you compare, China has about 26% and Brazil about 36%. Government of India is planning to push the enrollment rate to 30% by 2020. We have to see how it goes. The second challenge is the constraints on the research capacity and innovation. We have very low PhD enrollments in the country, and we don't have enough high-quality researchers. There are a few opportunities for interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary working, lack of early-stage research experience, which is resulting in a weak ecosystem of innovation and low levels of industry engagement. And overall, it is resulting in a low-quality teaching and learning environments. Now we have questions to the panelists. First, I would like to, ask Ajay what do you think is the role of the government, both at the center and as well as the state level, and what can be done to actually understand the complexity or the scale of the problem, and also proactively thinking about the feasible solutions. So, I'd like to understand your thoughts. And then, so I would request all the panelists to freely talk about their ideas.
I remember being in this campus exactly 20 years ago, and being a part of that, the first class which started, Professor Kaul started with mathematics. We were very keen that the institute should start with a mathematics class, and it did. And Professor Kaul started with a maths class, I think at 8:30 in the morning on 2nd September 1998. Just a day before that, after a fair amount of struggle and trying to keep to a deadline, we had been able to register the society. Srini was one of the signatories, and there were others basically from the industry who actually participated, because we didn't want this to be a government institution. We didn't want this to be a private institution. And these were the only two models that were existing then. So we had to actually dream up an institution which in a avatar or in a, you know, with a kind of DNA that didn't exist at all. The design was not there. So we considered it a public institution. An institution which is, as it has been mentioned, for, by, and of the society. Well, it's institutions that make or break the economy. So I get tempted to look back 20 years and see how we got started. A few key aspects about what we attempted. I think some of it has come out in the presentation that was made in Professor Raj Reddy's talk. Apart from imagining an institution which would neither be government nor private, we had to also look seriously at what kind of institutional avatar it would take. Would it be something supported by central government? Would it be something supported only by the state government? How would such a creature come into being? And all of it actually started from a slightly bigger effort of creating Hyderabad as a hub of excellence in IT. So the idea of this institution took shape alongside the idea of creating high-tech city and an excellent environment for industry to grow, and of making use of IT for the society, making use of IT to improve governance. And the third leg that was thought of was that it's necessary to have a lead institution that would actually spearhead this entire effort. So there were choices of whether to primarily make it an undergraduate institution, whether to concentrate on post-graduation and research. Because again, the institutions that existed then in the country, and many of those models still continue. IITs had, at that point of time, predominant focus on undergraduate, and a lot of their vitality used to come from the quality of undergraduates that they are able to attract. There were a number of postgraduate and research programs, but in some way they were, the vitality used to come from the undergraduate admissions. On the other side, we had TIFR and we had IISc, whose almost complete focus was on research and postgraduate education, leaving out the undergraduate side. So we also had to make an effort to combine these two. Because when we looked at MIT, Stanford, Carnegie Mellon University, and some of the top universities across the world, we saw that it's a combination, that research is going to be extremely important, postgraduate programs are going to be extremely important, but if we concentrate only on building research and postgraduate education, we will miss out on one of the most valuable resources that we have in this country. The tremendous talent pool which comes in at the undergraduate level. Sometimes if you focus only on building a postgraduate and research institution, you miss out on that. Because by that time, they have studied somewhere else and many of them have either gone over to jobs or to higher education elsewhere. So this is the combination that we attempted. Now, I think we took some hard choices, and today I think the result of those is apparent, both the successes and failures of the model, the path that we took. We decided to take the harder path. It would not have been very difficult for us to create another institution with both CapEx and OpEx tied in. But then we were seriously worried whether that will also, like other institutions which have assurance of CapEx and OpEx, capital expenditure and operating expenditure, whether such an institution would again be one among many. How would it be a distinct, an institution that is very special, an institution that focuses on extraordinary quality? So we took the path of a middle path of providing some support. It's more CapEx support, but it came in a different format. Leveraging some existing land and buildings, making it available in the initial stages at 1 rupee per year, and later on creating a model by which if the institution succeeds, and this institution did succeed, that the government would be tempted and would be able to actually transfer the ownership of the land and buildings to that institution. This is precisely what happened, and it was almost as per game plan. From day one, I think the institution has relied on its own resources for the operating expense. That has given the institution extraordinary autonomy. I think no other institution in the country actually enjoys this kind of autonomy. The new IIITs, I think, which follow more or less a similar model with greater infusion of funding from the government, again on the CapEx side, more on the CapEx side, are the closest that we have to this model. But this has also been a constraint. You know, an institution that could have possibly grown even faster has actually been able to grow at a particular, of course, I enjoy when you say that it's 33.33% CAGR for income. I think to my mind it should have been a 50% CAGR, and that's where probably our model has fallen short. How did we go ahead and give this? Because, you know, today we have to learn from what has worked and what has not worked, and from why exactly we did what we did, and how did we justify, how did we do it within a governmental system? I think right in the beginning, at that point, the dream was that we are taking Andhra Pradesh, we are taking India towards what we call a knowledge society. And if we really believe in the concept of knowledge society, then we have to see parallels in other, in the industrial sort of age, and see what is it that will drive the formation of the knowledge society. So we actually compared the model of what, you know, what a General Motors factory, for instance, would be able to do in the industrial age. That if a GM factory comes in, along with that comes a complete supply chain, comes a complete ecosystem. So in a sense, that becomes a mother institution. And we found that governments by that time had a clear model where if a major industry is, you know, is on the anvil, the central government, the state governments, the local governments would go out of the way in facilitating its establishment, would provide land, buildings at a nominal cost, free or at a nominal cost, would be happy to provide sometimes water and electricity. In fact, ISB was the biggest beneficiary of that, water and electricity free of cost. Electricity for first 5 years, free of cost. And lots of benefits to on the taxation front for many years to come. If it is an industry, a mother industry that is coming in, huge benefits on taxation. Why? Because that's a mother institution. If a General Motors factory comes, so will a large number of supporting units, ancillary units. And once the products are produced, a huge ecosystem gets built up for taking it to the market, for supporting it through a lifetime, around cars, all kinds of economic activity. And through that economic activity, the government is again able to get taxation. And the government has achieved what it set out, what it is meant for. Creating an ecosystem which creates huge amount of economic activity, provides opportunities to its people. And we felt that if we have to pull off something like this in what we imagine to be a, you know, move towards a knowledge society, then we have to look at if what is similar to a General Motors factory in the industrial society when it comes to a knowledge society. And we felt it is an institution of this kind. The spearhead is an institution, and institution like Stanford or MIT or Carnegie Mellon University or University of Texas at Austin, or institutions that have actually spawned significant ecosystems around them, made a not just institutions that are into teaching, institutions that actually aspire to something well beyond that. And so we were able to pull off, you know, giving a lot of things, making them almost free of cost, and yet not getting into the actual running of the institution, keeping, in a way, I think if the blame has to be taken, I have to take that blame squarely, in keeping the government away, in getting something from the government, in bringing government in to catalyze this kind of an institution, and then in maintaining an arm's distance from the government to ensure that there is no lid, there is no, you know, limit to what you can aspire to. Sometimes when you become dependent on budgetary finance in a governmental system, that also determines that from year to year, what is it you can do? At what rate can you grow? Which are the activities you can get into? Which are the research groups, research areas you can take up? how much faculty you can recruit, how much you can pay your faculty, what will you charge from your students, how will you run your research centers and research programs. Many of those things then get determined with other constraints. So sometimes having our own internal constraints is better than having external constraints which make it nearly impossible to rise to a level of excellence which we need for being a spearhead institution when you are thinking of a sort of a very significant change towards, you know, from being from the normal industry to a knowledge-based industry. So this is, you know, the path we took. For after having taken a very difficult route, I think we have done fairly well. There are many things that we have not been able to achieve, but what we have been able to achieve is very significant. Apart from the institution itself, one of the focuses was on what will we produce only graduates and postgraduates and PhDs? Will we do something more than that? Will we be able to connect to the society? Will we be able to contribute to the ecosystem around, to the economy of the state, to the economy of the country, to the global pool of, you know, the IT knowledge and products and services? So that's a very significant effort that we tried to make, that the institution should not just produce very competent graduates and postgraduates, we should also spawn other institutions. We should also spawn other ecosystems. So some of the things that you have seen, the MSIT program run through a, you know, bringing all the universities then in Andhra Pradesh together in a consortium to run an MSIT program with a lot of content and materials coming in from other, from foreign universities, and spawning many other institutions itself. I think this is what we have seen happening in Carnegie Mellon University, in Stanford, in some of the great universities across the world. And I think this particular model gives us the freedom and the flexibility and the autonomy to continue moving in that direction. And we should, every year, at any point of time, we should see what is it that, which are the areas and what is another ecosystem which would serve the purpose for India, for this part of India to actually contribute, say, to AI, ML, to AR and VR, to robotics, to drones, to cybersecurity, and not confine it only to what this institution can do by itself. Sometimes, you know, the other entities that are spawned by an institution can actually grow to be bigger and larger and seriously impactful across the world. From Carnegie Mellon University, you have seen the software engineering institution take shape. From Software Engineering Institute, you have seen the CMM, you know, certification take shape. You have also seen the concept of CERTs, the Computer Emergency Response Teams, take shape. Now, each of these today is probably, you know, hugely impactful. The CERT in India, the National CERT, the National CERT anywhere in the in countries across the globe, CERTs which look after sectors, all of them have come from the concept of certs that came from, I think, in some way, not even directly, but through an indirect route, through what was spawned by Carnegie Mellon University. I think it's very important that we concentrate on what kind of ecosystems will actually give us the results, not just what IIIT Hyderabad as an institution can do. Today, T-Hub has taken shape. T-Hub, I expect that in some period, there'll be a larger T-Hub. I think it's already taking shape. A much larger T-Hub than can be accommodated within IIIT Hyderabad, I think would take shape, and that is how it should be. NISG took shape in a limited, one of the buildings in one of the areas. Today, NISG is a far larger and more impactful entity. Similarly, we should keep looking at what are the major requirements and what kind of ecosystems to spawn. So we have a responsibility not just to produce students, to produce graduates, postgraduates, and PhDs. We should be a mother for spawning more and more institutions and more ecosystems. So these are some of the thoughts I have. Today, we are also looking at a very major transition, in a sense. Computer science was a sort of something that you could categorize. You could say, okay, this is agriculture, this is banking, this is education, the general education, this is the social sector, this is biotech, and this is computer science and IT. I think we are seeing a major transition. IT is moving into, has already moved, and is moving deeper into every domain. The digital technologies actually go well beyond what we started with. And they end up moving deep into each and every domain. Within a few years, I think we are moving towards a serious disruption in almost every domain of human activity, whether it is banking and finance, whether it is energy, whether it is transportation, whether it is manufacturing, more and more of IT and the digital systems will play a part. So much so that the digital part of these sectors will actually be the dominant part. And we will see serious amount of disruption happen in the existing models in energy, in transportation, in life sciences itself. IoT will bring in a large part of this change and many of the associated technologies. So we should, at this point when it is, when this institution is 20 years old, we should, in a way, think of, completely reimagine ourselves. Reimagine it for the next 20 years. Reimagine with what strengths and what limitations we have. I was told a few months ago, and I don't know what the score is now, a few months ago when I was just asking Professor P.J. Narayanan, how many people do we have in AI and associated areas? At that point, you had mentioned to me 27. There are 27. I don't think any other institution today has 27 faculty members who are associated in areas relating to AI. AI and the associated areas, the data science, data analytics, machine learning, deep learning, natural language processing, and so many factors which are associated with that. These are the core areas which are going to drive the change and the disruption in almost every sector of the economy. And this is where IIIT Hyderabad today, in this first 20 years journey, has been able to build an extraordinary strength. from now, how do we become, how does this institution become a part of the disruption, both in disrupting and in taking care of the associated pain with disruption, in sort of minimizing it for each and every sector? I think that is today a very major opportunity, and we should reimagine the institution around that journey, because that is, those are green shoots which we are seeing. We are not at the end of a period. We are at the beginning of another new and extremely exciting journey of computer science and everything digital, when it starts going deep into each and every sector. So how do we bring those sectors close to us? How do we bring ourselves close to those sectors? I think is going to be a very important part of the next phase of the journey. Fortunately, we have also green shoots around growth of electronics manufacturing in the country. For a certain period of time, I'm sorry, I'm taking more time. For some period of time, we saw Indian electronics take a back seat, almost to the point of getting wiped out. We are seeing a significant revival again. We have seen that in assembly of something very simple, assembly of mobile phones. And many people say, oh, what's so great about that? It's just, where is the value addition? You are bringing sub-assemblies in from all over, and then you are basically sort of putting the box together. But starting with that, I think we have built momentum where from 6 crore mobile phones, we moved in a year to 11.5, to 17.5, to 22.5 year on year. This is the kind of growth. And now we are starting to move deeper into the value chain. As I like to put it, the dulha has already come, the bridegrooms have come, the brands have come, and they are getting assembled here. The barat was left behind. It is in China, it is in Taiwan, it is in Japan, it is in Germany. The barat is still somewhere else. Now we are trying very hard, and Srini is a part of that effort. Telangana and Andhra governments, UP government, the governments are part of that effort. We are seriously trying to bring electronics manufacturing in. We are trying to bring the components, the sub-assemblies in. We are trying to bring the SMT lines, which is surface mounted technology, the PCB assembly lines in. This year we'll see almost a doubling of the PCB assembly lines or SMT lines in the country. Doubling. And once those components of the ecosystem are there, people quickly recognize that when you have the ability to do sub-assemblies and you have SMT lines, you can actually go on to make almost anything electronic. You don't have to remain confined to mobile phones. Anything electronic. Now imagine, in India, what do we have? We have strength in software. We have this brain power. We did not have the electronics half of the story. Suddenly we are seeing emergence of the electronics part of the story. Together, you know, I'll just again take a minute to explain one thing which, you know, from which I derive lessons. Last year I visited Asus Computers in Taiwan. I saw a robo called Zenbo. When Zenbo got introduced, it was at $600. It was a breakthrough kind of a price point. It could be used at home for certain purposes. Asus found the strength to actually market it, customize it, market it in Taiwan. And they also found the energy resources and all to do that for Japan. And after that, I think it ran extremely well. It was a breakthrough price point. But when I visited this place last year, about 3-4 years after Zenbo has taken shape, I found it a little sad-looking kind of robo. Why? I felt that had Zenbo taken shape, or had there been an opportunity to breathe life into it in Hyderabad, in Bangalore, in Pune, in Gurgaon, in NCR, we would have had the ability to customize it, to make it a product which could have served markets across languages, across regions, across geographies. That didn't happen. And there is only a certain shelf life in which this kind of activity has to happen. So for electronics to succeed, it is the software part which has to actually join up at the right time for this to happen. And I believe that our technology institutions today should make a serious effort to bring the hardware and the software, the electronics and the software elements, and the back-end kind of AI and associated technologies together. That is where we can find tremendous opportunities. And finally, just one point. Why will this happen in India? Why will this not happen only or mainly in Silicon Valley or in Shenzhen or such areas? I think we have one major advantage, and this goes back to what Professor Narendra Ahuja told me right in the, you know, in the first year he was the director here, founder director. And we were discussing as to, you know, why will this institution succeed here? And he told me it's a research institution, and research succeeds best where there are problems to solve. I think in India, we probably have the largest number of problems yet to be solved. If you look at pollution, if you look at transportation, if you look at water supply, if you look at power supply, if you look at traffic, if you look at food, if you look at, you know, the home environment, if you look at the factory environment, I think you can look in any direction and you will find that there are any number of problems to be solved. I think we are the biggest resource of unsolved problems, and unsolved problems are probably the single most important resource that we need when you have imagination, when you have software, when you have hardware. Then to bring a focus and make it, you know, what you need is to apply it to solve problems, and that is the resource which today fortunately we have here in India. So for the next many years to come, I think bringing the electronics and the software and the AI and associated technologies together, convergence, and then bringing them to bear on solving problems sector after sector after sector, I think that should be the goal of our institution. That should also be the goal of institutions of technology anywhere in the country. I'm sorry, I have taken much more time than was allotted, but these were thoughts which I wanted to share with you today. Thank you.